If you own a boat like one of these, the chances are you're rich or famous, or maybe both. But some are more famous than others. And in the 1950s, two Sydney men and their boats seemed to not only control our waterways, but our airwaves too. We followed everything they did, every word they uttered, every shark they caught, and we followed their long-standing and friendly public rivalry. They were, in fact, the kings of modern radio, and they made two phrases, hi-ho everybody and happy lathering customers, as much a part of the Australian language as fair dinkum.
You must remember this, a kiss is just a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. It's still the same old story, a fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
Jack, don't you wish you could get laughs like that, old boy?
Hi. I think I can, Bob.
You think you can get laughs like I did?
I think I can.
But how, Jack?
Well, here's a pie for you.
The two big D's, Davey and Dyer. For 20 years, they were the biggest names in local radio. Yet, ironically, neither of them was an Australian.
Never forget, your wife is on the telephone, you pick up the receiver and talk to her, and if you can convince her that you're at a mutual friend's house, I'll give you an extra £5. You right? All right, now take up the telephone and talk to her.
Hello, darling.
Hello, darling.
Oh, good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Davey.
Oh, how do you do? You... That's rather nice. I like when they call me by name. The sentry at the gate knew me by name.
I'm sure he did.
Hey, he said, out of the way, mug.
I'm at Ralph's place,
darling. Wait a moment. She says you're drunk.
No. I'm not drunk, darling.
The second son of a steamer captain, John Andrew Davey, was born in New Zealand. When he breezed ashore in Sydney in 1931 at the age of 20, he'd already failed as a sign writer and used car salesman. But somehow he talked radio station 2GB into giving him a job as a singer.
I don't know why you are missing, how I wish that we were kissing.
They said, oh yes, you can sing for us, Mr. Davey, for 3 guineas. So he said, okay, so he had to sing 3 times a week, and even the 3 guineas. And it's an actual, factual story, which I have from a person who knew him all his life, that he went into Park Street in the city, and he bought 3 suits, and ties, and shoes, and a motor car, within an hour of getting a job at 3 guineas a week. But when the end of the week came, he received a cheque for 9 guineas. So he said, 9 guineas. He said, Lou, if they're that careless with their money, they could have had me for 3. I knew this is where I belonged.
Just 3 months later, Davey had his own breakfast show, and within 2 years he'd added a daytime quiz programme, a music and variety show in the evening, plus the job of adding commentary to the weekly Movie Tone newsreel. Jack Davey was here to stay.
He's gone from us forever, our darling blue-haired boy.
At the same time, a poor white boy from Nashville, Tennessee, was carving out a career in show business the hard way. His name was Bob Dyer, and as a banjo-strumming hillbilly comedian, he did a vaudeville act called The Death of Willie, a send-up of the Hollywood craze for singing cowboys. By the late 30s, the American had made Australia his home, and fast-talking Bobby Dyer was topping the bill in variety shows up and down the country.
He could stamp his foot in the Martins and the Coys, they were records, you know, and there was no doubt about it. And when he told a gag, he whacked, you know, there was no uncertainty about anything he ever did. We did a big variety show once, and Dick Bentley and Jack Davey and Roy Reen and a couple of all these people were in the show, and Dyer was on, and he went on and did his bit. And when he came off, the boys were all sitting there in the chairs looking at him, and as he walked towards them through the curtains, he said, well, I may not be the funniest comic in Australia, but I'm the loudest. And Roy said, yes, you said it, pal.
In those frenetic radio shows of the early days, Bob Dyer relied heavily on the comedy tricks he'd learnt in vaudeville. It was slapstick radio, designed as much for the eye as the ear. And the crazier the stunts, the more the audience lapped it up.
The middle one! Now, wait a minute, there's only one way to find out. Here's a knife. Now, it's right on top of the melon. And now, go, when I count three, cut. One, two, three! Mr. Mitchell, Mr. Ray Mitchell, your penalty will be to wheel this pram with Rod Holmes along Pitt Street tomorrow afternoon at 1:30 from King to Market Street. If you do that, you will come back here next Monday and receive £50 for paying the penalty. Can you take it?
Yes.
He can take it!
Stunt shows like Can You Take It were amazingly successful for Dyer long before he'd asked his first quiz question. The thousands of Sydneysiders who jammed the city streets to watch Mr. Ray Mitchell wheel his pram for £50 gives some idea of the enormous popularity radio enjoyed in the 40s. These were the vintage days.
A nice easy one for you. Name me four songs that have parts of the body as title, such as A Call to Arms. You get the idea?
Yes, Mr. Davy.
Good.
First one I'd say was Dark Eyes.
Dark Eyes, very good. Beautiful.
The second one I'd say Scatterbrain.
Scatterbrain, yes. You're getting a little deep for us, but that's good. Come
and,
on, two more. Time
here
is...
we are again.
Here we are again. Here we are again. That's beautiful. Here we are again. All right, and one more, quick. Quick, here goes the gong.
Black Bottom.
The Jack Davy style was almost the complete opposite to Dyer's. Through 25 years of quiz programs, the ad-libbed good humour of Davy at the microphone was the most familiar sound on commercial radio.
I think very early in the piece, the great secret was he knew that there was humour in people themselves. He turned away the humour from himself. Like the one he asked when he said to the boy, what is a brazier? And the boy said, oh, he said, I'll cup hell when I get home, he said, but it's that thing that holds a woman together. And then Jack said, together or apart? And the way they went again, yeah, you yeah. see. And, of course, the audience loved it. But he turned back the humour to people themselves. He had innate confidence in the humour of people.
All right, come to Jaggy. That's the idea. Right up close. Your name?
Private Beckman.
Private Beckman.
Yes.
A nice, easy question for you. Fairly hard. This one is 10 shillings. The first recorded accent into the air by man took place over 150 years ago, and the man who achieved this then remarkable feat was von Zeppelin or one of the Wright brothers.
De Rozier. He was a Frenchman, and he rose to a height of 100 feet in a fire balloon.
That's very good. You answered that amazingly.
Well, I ought to. Before joining the AWAS, I passed an exam on aeronautics.
Yes. Thank you very much. Would you give me A? Again, please. That'll be near enough.
Davy was a natural entertainer and a compulsive worker. He did much more than just host a string of quiz programs. He headed his own radio production unit, writing, producing, directing, as well as starring in a gigantic output of material.
You thought I was going to be lousy, didn't you?
At a time when the American radio stars were proud of finishing 30 shows a year, Davy once made 680. And on top of all that, his super smooth style was much in demand for its selling potential.
Sunbonnet blue.
You see, ladies and gentlemen, there's no doubt about the stuff that I feed into the microphone of this end. It's irresistible. It's good. But how do I appear at your place? Something like this?
Hi, hello, everybody. You see what I mean? I left the studio looking and sounding beautiful, and I arrive here looking like a Sydney tram.
Place a Bayer's aspirin tablet here, and twist here.
Gee, Dad, that was quick.
Junior, it's always quick when I use my new Buck electric dry shaver.
But while Davy was busy making money for other people and commanding a healthy income himself, his personal extravagances cost even more. He gambled heavily, drove flash cars, and generally seemed hell-bent on trying to outdo his own playboy image. It was all wonderful grist to the publicity mill, but it also caused his employers constant heartburn.
But the company provided Jack with a brand new Chrysler car, and came a week, the car didn't turn up. So we said to Jack, what's happened to the car, Jack? Oh, he said, I sold that. But he says, Jack, we said, Jack, that's a, that wasn't yours to sell, that's a company car. Oh, he said, I thought you gave it to me. So the following day, he walked into the managing director's office, a gentleman by the name of S.R.I. Clark, and he emptied out his pockets. He'd been to Baccarat the night before, and he tumbled out a couple of £1,000 out of his pockets. He says, yeah, that's square it all up, boss.
Davy's mark was entertainment, making people laugh. And it wasn't long before he was even building comedy spots into the newsreels. The soul of every weekend gardener was stirred by his double-barreled assault on the dreaded snail. And despite confident beginnings, he never managed to back a winner on Melbourne Cup Day. But his best-remembered excursions were as Gertie the Girl Guide, ready to try anything in return for her willing shilling. But as the years wore on, the off-screen truth was less amusing. Overwork, whiskey and cigarettes were all taking their toll. Television was just around the corner, and for Jack Davey, it was the beginning of the end.
These fellas are really ravenous. You'll go a long way to match this for sheer ferocity.
By the 1950s, Davey and Dyer just about had the airwaves to themselves, and they reveled in it. The first of the post-war superstars, they didn't mind publicising their extracurricular activities. A private life was something you talked about, but never had. Bob Dyer's decision to settle in Australia was confirmed when he met a lovely young Tivoli showgirl, Dolly Mack. 18 days later, they were on their honeymoon at where else but Surfers Paradise. It was the beginning of one of the most successful partnerships in Australian show business. True to character, Davey's leisure time activities were a trifle more flamboyant. He entered the Round Australia reliability trials that were all the rage, and in 1956 he actually went close to winning. But while Davey clung on to his old gallivanting image, it was actually Bob and Dolly who were having the good time. While they could set off on yet another overseas fishing expedition, Davey's health was failing to the point where life had become a constant battle to stay out of hospital.
No!
Roman countryman!
Oh, Johnny! Oh, how wonderful. Jack! Oh. Jack, I notice a family resemblance in these worms.
Now, listen, this is important. Yeah. We want to keep up Australia's reputation. You mightn't get the biggest, but I got a bit of a help for you.
Have you? What's this he got now here? What's it? Oh, Jack, 500 pounds! Boy, this'll do it.
Catch him, open his mouth, push it in, small end first. Weigh it.
Like you always do.
At least it's a chance. Well, it's the only way with me. I fit so little.
Jack, thank you so much. I'm only sorry you're not on the team with me, but next year maybe, boy, huh?
Next year.
In the next 7 years, Davey would be hospitalized 9 times. He was plainly a sick man, and his friends didn't need to look far for the causes.
Hard work. Although he said, bite off more than you can chew and then chew like buggery. That was his own expression. Yeah. But he rationed himself to 4 hours sleep a day. He said if Napoleon could do it, I could.
By the time Davey's sponsors took him into television, the dynamo was visibly running out of steam. His happy-go-lucky production style, where mistakes could be taken out afterwards, wasn't possible on live television.
Well, you were very good. You didn't put a hand up. You just crawled out, but just as well you did, because I was nearly out of goods and nearly out of time. So that was it. Give you the card. A candle. I'm no use unless I'm lightheaded. Time to go, and I must hurry. Get up and say hello.
In contrast, Bob Dyer took to television like a marlin to water. In many ways, it must have seemed like being back in vaudeville. And during his very first appearance on Australian TV, Dyer made sure to keep his newfound career in the family.
I want you to meet her officially because you'll be seeing a lot of her in television. This is my gal, Dot. Amazing.
Bob Dyer wasn't just a star on television. He understood it. With 30 years of showbiz experience behind him, he soon realized that to grow old gracefully on television, a personality had to learn to maintain maximum exposure with minimum effort.
But he could see to sit down each week and write variety with all the gags and situations, it's hard work. Whereas he could see what Jack was doing, but you've got a series of quiz questions and a few ladies coming up, you see, and ask him and get some material out of that. Seemed to be the way to go long term.
I ceased to be an entertainer after the first year of television. I found out that being an entertainer was too much of a demand, and it ate up too many people and put too many people in the graves and in insane asylums. So I started being myself, and I became what I would call an entrepreneur. I'm not an entrepreneur, I'm a showman. And being a showman is being myself and engineering things and deciding situations such as a quiz show, which I used to look down my nose at quiz shows in vaudeville and radio. I wouldn't be in it. I thought anybody can ask questions and give money for correct answers, but there's more than meets the eye.
Pick a box, and your host, Bob Dyer.
Who was the first Governor General, British Governor General of India?
Now, there are two.
His name.
Two answers. Look, it could be either Canning or Mountbatten, because Canning was Governor General of India in 1858,
yes.
And Mountbatten was Governor General of India in 1948. Now, it could be either of those two.
One of those two, huh?
Hmm.
The first.
You mean with the actual title of Governor General of India? The former Governor Generals were called Governor General of Bengal.
Uh-huh.
And earlier, of course, the first Governor General of Bengal was Warren Hastings. But he was only Governor General of Bengal. He was, in effect, Governor General of India. But he only held the title of Governor General of Bengal.
Customers, I find myself in a dilemma.
Look, I know.
Bob Dyer's history, his record, was essentially that of a theatre man. He was a theatre man who worked in radio because he saw it in a way as a kind of an analogy to the theatre, but when television came on, he applied his theatre technique very successfully. And he really was a man of very great ability. I always had a great respect for his ability, although he played the role of the country yokel in some ways, particularly in earlier years. I thought that he was a man of very real ability.
That's because the uncle of the present Duke.
You see, they dropped the
uncle of the present Duke. Yep. I knew that. Right. Yep. I knew that. See, I knew that. Yeah. I just wanted to get that in, but yep. I happen to know that.
Well, you better pick a box.
Yeah. Mr. Hardy, I'd like to pick one for you right now.
Oh, how big?
Whenever I had the chance on pick a box, I certainly didn't mind rattling away, particularly if it was something that I was keenly interested in. And sometimes when a question came up, it would deal with something that meant a lot to me personally, and so I'd go on about it.
Prior to that, they were known as Governor Generals of Bengal.
Well, why did you bring Mountbatten into it?
Because they then took the title of Viceroy of India.
Barry Jones, the Melbourne schoolteacher, showed just how big the quizzes had become. When they started, Dyer and Davy were giving away a top prize of 5 shillings. But by the time Barry Jones walked away from Pick a Box, he took with him more than $58,000 in cash and prizes.
I wouldn't be at all surprised when then when he retired, Sri Chakravarti Rajaja Palachari became the first Indian.
Well, hello. Nice to be back at work again. Goodness me, it's been a long spell. 20 years I've been on the newsreel, and that's the longest I've ever been away from it. But we must get on with the story. What's the first story? The Caulfield Cup 1954. Couldn't start on anything better. You know, I've been worried, very worried. Been a little sick, but fine now. But all that worries me is, take a look at this. Have you ever seen trout? 3 months ago I bought them. 3 months ago with vacant possession. And look, there's room for... Goodness me, my shoes are filthy.
By the end of the 50s, television was decimating radio's nighttime audience. And one of the first casualties was Jack Davy. Gaunt and tired, he was now reduced to appearing as a mystery guest on one of his old rival shows. At his peak, Davy claimed more than 5 million listeners a week. But this last appearance on television gave little hint of those former glories.
Come on out. Hi-ho, everybody!
The doctors had confirmed that he was now dying of cancer. He knew it, and so did his close friends.
How do you like being on TV?
Oh, I love it. I love it, Bob. I think it's really got something. I enjoy it. It's lots of fun, and I feel I'm sort of getting used to it, and it's getting better all the time, and I am, and
I'm getting fatter. Look at this.
Yeah. Long way to go.
Yeah, but still, it's a worthwhile journey.
Perhaps I can best describe it by using Jack's words. He said, "What are you crying for?" He said, "I'm the one that's going to die." And I said, "Well, you're only 49 years of age." And he said, "Lou, but I've had 100 years of living." He said, "I can show you people walking up Pitt Street, 100 years of age," he said, "that haven't lived 50 of them." He said, "I'm lucky. I can say goodbye to all my friends." So he said, "It's a good time to go." And I said, "I can't see that." I said, "Because all the good that you're doing and all the good that you've done dies with you." And he said, "Well, you don't know. You're guessing."
During the last days of his life, Jack Davey made his friends promise there'd be no cheap funeral for the King of Radio. It seems the born showman couldn't face the thought of not going out in style. He needn't have worried. 150,000 people packed the streets to watch the cortege pass by. It was the biggest funeral Sydney had seen since the death of Billy Hughes.
Everywhere crowds stand silent and hushed, paying their respects to a star in the world of entertainment. Australia is poorer at his passing.
Bob Dyer's television career had another decade to run, and he brought to the medium the kind of energy and professionalism thousands still remember. His work in Pick a Box and the BP Super Show earned him an OBE in the Queen's Honours, and in 1971, the television industry itself honoured him with their highest award, a Gold Logie.
Well, to say I'm overwhelmed would be the understatement of the century. I'm fabber-bloody-gasted.
Today, with a wardrobe full of Logies, Bob and Dolly Dyer have retired quietly to the Gold Coast, the place where they first went on their honeymoon 40 years ago. Their only address is a post office box, and the telephone has an unlisted number. In show business, that's really being retired. Their old friend Jack Davey kept performing till his last gasp, but Bob and Dolly said, "That's it," and it was.
I have one thing to say to all of you who are assembled here would probably appreciate. I promise you this won't happen again.
You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental thing.